Thanks, Brian, and good afternoon, everyone. It's actually very good to be here in Cowra again. It has been a while, but I always have a fantastic time in Cowra. And Brian, thank you for making it possible that this exhibition is on now, because it was actually going to be in March, and then we waited and was so excited. But thank you for that possibility in this year of pandemic upheaval. And I also want to thank the team of volunteers who made installing this exhibition like a dream. It was so easy, and there's a few here. So thank you for them. It's a pleasure to welcome Yvonne Boag and her husband Bob, sitting there. And it's now my pleasure to tell something of a background to Yvonne's work and to her life. Yvonne actually is Glaswegian-born printmaker, painter, sculptor, and arrived with her family in South Australia in 1964, relocating to another continent at the age of 10, had a profound effect on Yvonne's future life as an artist, how she experienced migration and dealt with themes of displacement in her work. After graduating, she lived and worked in many different places in Australia, Melbourne, Sydney, the Lockhart River Aboriginal Community, and in Paris for 3 years. But it is South Korea which stole her heart and has dominated her work since she first visited in 1993. Curating Yvonne's exhibition turned out to be a great experience. I actually traveled with her through memory lane, which gave me an inside story about her nomadic existence, which I used to tell the story in this exhibition. Working in print studios in Japan, Korea, France, UK, and the printmaker studio in Aberdeen was very important, because there in 1989, she saw the work by Scottish artist Roger Hilton and William Scott. Both artists greatly influenced her work, as in Scott's abstract work, drawn from still lifes, figures, and landscapes, Yvonne's semi-abstract forms combine areas of color with line and strong graphic forms in her paintings, prints, and drawings. Becoming the central focus of her work, she communicates her ideas of displacement through visual images, objects, and places. She feeds off this dislocation, and her work embodies the discomfort experienced when you feel you don't belong. Her latest work are in response to the everyday reality of life in South Korea. And Yvonne says that the shapes are the words, the colors the turning. I have known Yvonne for a long, long time, but mainly as a printmaker. And I'm so happy because she acknowledges the importance of this medium and talks about it, that painting is important, but printmaking gives me a way of looking at my paintings and thinking about them in a more organized manner. And that brings me to her notebooks and artist books, which I included in this exhibition. Yvonne said that she never imagined I wanted to use her little notebooks. But yes, they are so relevant as part of her story, as a traveler and keen surveyor of her surroundings. These are her immediate thoughts relating to her later paintings. It is so much part of her creative thinking, getting that first note or touch on paper. She commented, and I quote, Wherever I go, I buy the cheapest stuff in the local art shop. So that changes the way the book looks. Strange designs and colors and new materials. The feeling of the country comes into the book. In Japan, it was very bright and colorful. And Paris was quite different. Each country has its own feel for the stuff I use. I like that stuff, actually. Well, her travels. I think that her travels are off the cards for now because of COVID-19. But this pause might bring her renewed motivation and challenges, and I think she needs new challenges, starting at the end of 2020 with new work, and in 10 years' time we are back in this exhibition, Beautiful Gallery. So you better work. It's for me an absolute pleasure to open this exhibition. Traveling, leaving, settling, Scotland, Korea, Australia, the story of an unsettled nomadic Scottish artist, and it is told by a Dutch curator. Thank you. We are now hopefully getting you to talk.
Okay.
And I have some not so difficult questions. So would you like all to come and follow us? These are actually probably the oldest works, the paintings anyway, in the exhibition. And what is quite interesting is that I placed it next to one of the newest 2019 works. Now, I'm going to start with, when I look at your work, it is very much Yvonne Boag. And what I mean about that is, you could have been an artist I met in Scotland, in the Netherlands, but by definition, I think that your work is not really influenced by Australian landscape. You might have, I think, certainly not the color, but maybe you disagree.
No, I agree. I do. I've always wondered where my landscape work belongs. It is just me, I suppose. And I think whenever I'm working from Australian landscape, I do it in a way that is referred to my experience in other countries.
Yeah.
So definitely, and then when I see how Australian artists, my peers, have done the same landscape, I think, oh, I'm a little bit out of sync with that, but that's where it is.
But what I also find very interesting, actually, is that the figures, I mean, these are one of the few figure paintings I saw, and your figures are very much in your prints.
Yes, it seems like the prints have much more figurative work, and the paintings are more abstract and landscape. And it just happens, I'm not really sure why. I think in a smaller scale, I place the story of people, whereas in the larger scale, it's the world or the space that we inhabit.
Well, we might actually try and walk to the main painting there. The houses, the forms, and a very interesting
lockup.
You have to talk about the time you were in lockup.
Well, I I was in lockout in the mid-90s. I started to go up there. I'd go in July because it's right up the top of Cape York Peninsula, halfway. It's almost at the top. From Cairns, you get an airplane. It's like an hour or 2 hour flight from Cairns in a small airplane. So it's a long way up and it's very hot and humid. So I go in July because it's winter. And I met the young artists in Canberra at a print symposium. The young Aboriginal artists came from Lockhart to Canberra to go to a print symposium because they were going to start a print workshop in their community. And I met them there and I just started chatting to them and they told me how they knew nothing about printmaking, but they wanted to do this workshop. And I said, well, if I can get up there, I'll show you how to do it. I'll help you to set up something to do with printmaking. So they managed to get me up there the first time. And I stayed for a month and we set up a little workshop and did a little printing. And I got to know the artists were about 17 at that stage, 17 years old on average, the young women and men. And I just decided, it was just such a wonderful experience. I kept going back every year for a month or so, for at least, I think it's 4 or 5 years. And we built up a relationship and they became great artists and have done very well themselves. But the effect on me was amazing. That what I learned from their work was incredible. I found a new way of seeing, which I had come, earlier in the 90s I'd been living in Paris. So coming to Lockhart and seeing this different way of seeing and everything tilted down like this and these lines, I've never used lines like that. And I got this sense of freedom and openness and responding completely to what was around me without thinking about how I should do everything. I do it the way I like. Because up there, they didn't care. And they're using house paint because you can't use normal paint because it goes moldy. So you have to have house paint with all the chemicals in it to keep it stable. So that also gave me more freedom and printing. Making small lining prints. The lining prints over here are both from Lockhart, and I cut the lining prints when I was sitting on the veranda of the community centre. The community centre is in front of a big open space, and all the houses are around that space. And in the late evening, the kids and people would come out and start playing and talking and chatting, because then it was cooler. So this is what that's about. But this is some of the houses that are all up on stilts because of the heat. So I actually printed them in Lockhart. And this was used to demonstrate to the artists what they could do. And so they went on and made prints, started to sell them, and started to earn money, and then were able to leave Lockhart and visit Cairns and visit different places having exhibitions. So they've actually become very well-known artists, a lot of them. So it was really a great chance for me to be there with them in the beginning and see their early development and learn from them.
I remember Rosella.
Rosella Namok, yeah.
Because we Rosella Namok was actually for the first time at the Sydney Art and Paper Fair. And we printed those very simple little prints and we had a line from one end to the other. With
pegs,
tags, and
pegs.
Pegs.
Yeah.
We pegged them all there on the line,
yeah,
to let them dry, which was absolutely fantastic.
And she was on the 18 then.
And then she went walkabout,
yeah,
in Sydney, so we lost her.
Yeah, for a few days.
Sorry.
But that was their first. That was those artists' first experience of Sydney. It was amazing.
Yeah, it was very.
But this is also looking out into the sort of circle where they would live. And this is actually the edge where the buildings are. And there's six different language groups living there. And so it was like six different families. And they sort of had the colors actually donate, in my mind, the different families and languages that were spoken in those houses.
Yeah. So maybe we go, I mean, this was actually, where are you?
Yeah, this one's in Korea. This is, in Korea, there's an artist, he's from the 17th century, and he was the first Korean artist who made images of ordinary peasants' life. And he became very famous. and I can't pronounce his name.
Sorry.
It's very difficult. But he, in the area in Seoul where he lived and he worked, there's now a museum. And that museum asked three artists to go out and go to the places where he drew in the 1700s and do work ourselves there. And I went, and there was a building site there doing high-rise, making high-rise building. And his painting is an idyllic country scene with farmers thrashing the wheat and all that. And then this is what was there when I was there. So each of the artists, there was two Koreans and me, we did the work, and this was my work. It's Gwangsang Gu. Gu is the area, Gwangsang. And so instead of an idyllic scene, I had this hole in the ground with cranes, everything. But at the same time, I still found it quite an amazing place because of the sky and the shapes. And I often thought, what would he think of it? But, you know, I was lucky that they allowed, you know, asked me to do that and be part of the exhibition, because I felt like I was being included in the Korean art scene of that in Seoul. So that was good.
It's so interesting because it's all the countries where you have stayed are hanging here. The countries are hanging here. But do you think that your work has radically changed over the years? I mean, as in ideas and execution of the creative process and direction.
It has changed because I think I'm getting much better at eliminating the stuff I don't need, and knowing what I'm wasting my time with, and knowing what might be essential for me. That's something that's changed. But if I look right back to when I first started, there's certain elements that are still there, but I've made them more relevant in some way.
Yeah.
Got rid of the superfluous. I'm aiming for that. Maybe in the end, just have nothing.
Well, that's right. We might actually go, because over the years you have produced artist books, prints, you're still there.
Mm-hmm.
And actually the one I really want you to talk about before we go to the artist books is this work.
Seoul Ferry. That was a ferry that had a whole school full of high school children on it, and it sank out on the just outside of Korea on the way to an island, and 338 children were trapped in the boat and drowned. And this, after 1 year, they raised the boat up and put it onto the dock in Mokpo, down on the bottom near Busan. And I was there at the time, and I did these big drawings of it. And it was this great big dead hulk, but there were still bodies in it. That's why they pulled it up, so they could get bodies out. And the suffering and the sadness that that story brought to the whole of Korea, to all parents and people who have ever had anything to do with young teenagers could feel. I mean, my son was only a few years older than some of these, and they were told to stay in their cabins and everything was all right, and it was just such a disaster. It's very hard to discuss. But that's the only thing. I could never do any more than that drawing. Wow. That was it.
Yeah.
And it's done in the traditional Korean way,
yeah,
which is a sumi art, which is brush and ink, and it's on mulberry paper. And in the Korean traditional way of painting, you paint on very thin paper. You paint on one side or both sides. You could put color on the back. And then you laminate it on thicker and thicker paper until it becomes quite stiff and strong. And then you hang it up in your house, and then when you're not looking, you roll it up and put it away. So it's very convenient for Korean houses that were made with paper walls and not always so permanent. So I did this using wheat glue. You mix it up, stir it up, and make it. And I learned to do this in 1995 from a Korean professor of Korean painting. So the, in art schools in Korea, you have Western painting and Korean painting, quite distinct. And the traditional Korean way of painting is very different than the Western way. So I actually learned from him how to work that way. And
it's like a shinkole.
Yeah. And it's quite, we have to tape it on the wall, and the bigger it gets, the more awkward it gets. Sometimes you end up wrapped in it.
I absolutely, I mean, for me, this is paper.
And this paper is hanji paper. Yeah. It's mulberry, it's made by farmers. And there's so many varieties and so many, and each paper has a use. And they even made paper for clothes, they make paper for the walls, paper for the floor. Paper was like a building material, a working material, drawing material, everything.
We might now actually probably finalize a little bit with artist books.
These are the ones I made in Paris.
Yeah. And tell me about, was this also one, was by Jorg de Souza?
Jorg de Souza, this one. And Nancy Soul bought this one.
Yeah.
It's a press. Little hand press, it's called. Because the lithography, these are lithographs, and lithography is usually done on very large stones and very hard to move around. But Nancy had invented a little tiny press that she could carry from studio to studio with tiny little stones this size. So all the little images are little tiny images on that one. So.
And I still remember Jorge and his small room in Paris.
And
he was so. Printing around him was absolutely wonderful. They are really gems of the artist books and beautiful lithography. And I would have liked actually to include a lot more artist books because it tells you so much about the artist.
Actually in the workshop printing.
So if we then make our way there, and if you want to sort of on your way talk about
this,
the abstractness of Andrea.
Yeah, this part. 2000, I had a year where I hated art. I hated everything to do with art. I hated galleries, I hated the whole lot. So I stopped even going or looking at art books, stopped going to galleries, stopped working for a whole year. I was so angry about the whole thing. I can't remember why. And then I was in Seoul, and I went to see an exhibition, and it was De Buffet, and it was his last work. And it was the first exhibition I'd been to since I'd stopped for a year. And I saw it in this 80-year-old man's work, and I thought, that's what it's about. This is what it means. Mm. And then I just started again. And when I came back to do my work, I found that I'd become really much simpler and much clearer and more relaxed. So it was actually a good thing to stop. And I think this was when I was trying to get going again. And the rhythm, it was all about rhythm and peace, finding some peace in the rhythm of things. Like this one, because the red is that size, all these other things had to be that size, and it became a relief to me to know I got it the way I wanted.
So then we might actually finish, if that's all right, with the books she didn't want to have in the exhibition. These are, I think, so much your immediate, can I call it, impulses?
Yes.
But what I also think and thoughts, and I find it's so important, paper is so direct. Your brain, your hands, the pencil in the hand comes on the paper. But you also have included, or I have included, the more square, simple ones and the very busy ones. And please tell.
Well, a lot of them have I cut out the news. I read the Korea Times, English, because it's the only one in English. And before the internet was so available, we used to get the Korea Times. I cut out words I like, because sometimes they're very strange words. And then I just put them in a box and pull them out. And it sort of just evolved. But it's a way of making sense of every day. But I wasn't trying to make any sense of it. I just had nothing else to do, because I had no television or anything. So at night I would sit and make these books, and just the colours and the shapes, and they were completely without precognition or something. They were sort of just flowing. And afterwards, when I look back at them, I can say, oh yeah, that was then. I can remember that time and what was happening then. But there's absolutely no real meaning to any of them. It's just,
but it made sense to
made
me.
Made sense.
So I.
And there's a lot of the different things that happened in Korea at different times come up in the text. And sometimes I use Korean translations into English, which is quite odd and changes everything. And I like the absurdity of it and the history about different times that the North started to come into South Korea and all. In the newspapers, you'd get all these sort of different articles. So it's all in there somewhere.
Well, I'm extremely happy that you were away when I picked them out and pushed them away.
I've got a cupboard full of them. I haven't really shown them to. They've not been shown anywhere.
No. And there are also some more in the library. So at least I could get some more there as well. I think. For me, my questions have dried up, but maybe you have a lot of questions. She's happy to answer, or if you want to just have a look around and then go and ask her when she is there and take her, might be a little bit easier. So thank you very much, actually. I enjoyed every little bit of making your life difficult, madam.
Didn't make it difficult, very, very easy. Thank you so much for all your work.
Oh no, it's great. It was a pleasure to hang the show. And
it's been an eye opener for me to see things I put together that I would never have imagined had relationships, and then seeing that they do have certain relationships. Very strange.
They do. Yeah. So thank you, and thank you for listening. And as I said, please ask her difficult questions. Thank you.
Thank you.